If you are at all interested in Nevada and American history, you can and you should come here to the Nevada National Security Site. Let's go look around. I got your clearance.
The atomic test site is divided into about 30 areas, each with their own history, some of them still active today. Darwin Morgan, Director of Public Affairs, guides me across the immense space to points of interest. First on the list is Area 5, also known as Frenchman Flat.
We are in Frenchman Flat. Huge historical significance. Tell me about this place.
So this is where the first bomb was dropped on the United States in January 27, 1951, and we did a total of 14 atmospheric tests on this dry lake bed.
But help me out. I thought that we were testing in the South Pacific back at the time.
So the United States was doing all of its testing in the Pacific, but it was a big haul to get there. The safety, the security started to weigh on the scientists and the politicians. And so a decision was made to look for an on-continent test site to do the lower yield tests. December 18th, 1950, the president signed the paperwork establishing the Nevada Proving Grounds. 45 calendar days later, they dropped the first bomb on the United States.
Incredible. Now, what about the structures that are here? What am I looking at?
So these are all structures that were to understand the heat and blast effect on a different type of structure. So you have a bridge right here, and they wanted to understand what was going to happen to it, and they were able to see that the I-beams basically turned into pieces of spaghetti when that heat hit it, the force hits it, and they just got that U curve that's in them. It was just fantastic.
What about the bank vault?
So there is a bank vault out here working. Back at the time with the Mosler Bank Vault Company, built a bank vault so they could understand how to make a bank vault that's gonna survive. If we're in a nuclear war, we have a nuclear catastrophe, is the money gonna be safe? And yes, everything inside the bank vault survived. It took a 20-ton crane to pull the door off of its hinges.
Now, I know ground zero for these tests were close by. They're probably, what, half a mile away?
We're within half mile, three-quarters of a mile of ground zero. They wanted to have the structures close to the ground zero and then repeated those different structures at varying distances so they could see what the heat and blast would be at this distance, and further out.
What about today when people come out here? What do you see? How do you see them react?
So we bring out monthly public tours here. And when the people come out and see this, there's a silence as they recognize the power of the atomic bomb, what it could do, because these structures sit here in silent homage to that time and are able to show people what exactly happened and what the force of those bombs could be.
You just said it exactly right. There's this silence, and then there's this feeling, at least inside of me, of just awe. It's just incredible.
Some tests gauged the destructive power of atomic weapons, while others explored the constructive applications of controlled blasts. The area known as Sedan bears the results of this experiment, a scar in the earth 4 football fields long and 300 feet deep.
You know, Darwin, when you first come up to Sedan, this area, it literally is breathtaking. Give me some details about this.
So there was a program for peaceful uses of nuclear weapons. It was called the Plowshare Program. And the entire idea of this was to see if you could use a nuclear bomb to dig another Panama-type canal, if you could make bigger harbors for the ships to come into. This was to see if you could use a nuclear device for digging.
So what did they do? They dug a hole and put a device down there and exploded it?
So they took a 104-kiloton nuclear bomb, put it down 635 feet, and it created the crater that we're standing in front of today.
And what did they find out, that you could use this for canals? Because I don't recall that ever being done.
Right, so in theory, it works perfectly. It's a great idea, but the problem and the issue is, and the United States never did this, is because of the residual radiation that you have left behind.
Boy, that explosion must have just been incredible.
To see the video of it, to see the cloud as it's forming, and you see these rocks blowing away, those rocks are the size of VW vans.
It's easy to come here and be floored by the scale of the devastation left in the wake of testing, but more impressive are the structures built later to contain and minimize damage. Towers like Ice Cap mark where the tests went underground.
Ice Cap is a tower which was going to be the last underground test by the United States in 1992. We were working to conduct this test, but The nation said, we're going to go into a moratorium. We're not going to do any more nuclear testing. And so we have this facility kind of sitting here as a showcase to show what it took to conduct an underground nuclear test.
How close was it to being functional, to working?
It was within 4 to 6 weeks of the test being conducted.
It's almost like they just locked the doors.
Right. They walked away. Literally, you can walk into buildings from the end of testing, including ICECAP, and still see telephone books from the time and some of the papers on the desk, the coffee cups, the empty coffee cups, pens, pencils. They just literally, like you said, walked away, shut the doors, locked them, and walked away.
Despite all the relics on the surface, only 100 nuclear tests ever occurred above ground. Over 820 tests were conducted in subterranean shafts. These towers allowed workers to safely prep the experiments below.
So this is where the device would be located. This entire area would have a shield around it, and then the pumps, like I was telling you below, would bring that cold air, and they would bring it to a vacuum.
So that would be the nuclear device.
That's where it would be, is in that location right there. And then looking at the device, you have all of these various pipes that are looking at different angles of it. They're looking at different places within the device so they can understand what's happening in that millionth of a second. And they're getting hundreds and hundreds of data points from that are going up these cables, again, before this entire thing is vaporized.
Was that the relative size?
That is a mock-up that's put in there just to show you where the device was going to be. At the time, we had a treaty with the Russians that allowed them to verify our test to make sure that we were not exceeding the 150 kilotons. They had full access to this to assure that we were not cheating on the 150 kiloton limit.
So they would come and inspect?
They had the option on this particular test to do it. They chose not to.
The former nuclear test site no longer tests atomic weapons, but proudly continues to use its environment to gather information and practical solutions in the name of national defense.
It's rare to find a spot that is so historic and so current and active at the same time. Tell me about this area.
So back on May 5th, 1955, this was the site of a 29 kiloton test called the Apple II test. And the test itself is historic in that it was the test that you see that famous footage of the houses, which some still are standing back there, of the houses being destroyed that had the mannequins inside of it.
So this was where we're standing is really kind of ground zero for that explosion. And those houses that are still standing are about how far?
We're looking at the nearest house that we can see is about 7,500 feet from us, and the furthest house is at 10,000 feet from us.
That is just amazing. And yet today, this is very active. So local law enforcement from around the country come here to train?
So after the Murrah Federal Building bombing in Oklahoma City, it was determined that our firefighters, police officers, really didn't understand how to use radiation detection equipment. So they asked, is there anybody that can teach them how to do it? We said here at the Nevada National Security Site, we can teach you how to do that in a real world environment where there's real radiation, where a real nuclear bomb went off.
See, I think most people think of this site and they think of, well, that's where those bombs went off a long time ago. Don't really realize that there's still a lot going on here.
Right, and with the residual radiation at safe levels that we can bring first responders into, we can take a historic site and turn it into something to help our national security today.
Though active nuclear testing stopped in the 90s, there's still maintenance required. The JASPER system functions as part of the stewardship program, upkeeping the U.S.'s current nuclear arsenal.
We're at a facility called JASPER. What is that?
JASPER stands for Joint Actinide Shock Physics Experimental Research. This is the only gun that you can fire a projectile at a piece of plutonium.
So how does it work in layman's terms?
Sure. So on this end here, you have this piston that is driven by high explosives. It travels down this tube. It compresses a gas. And as that gas builds up the pressures going down the tube, it ruptures this valve. And you can feel how heavy that is. And on the other side of it is this projectile, 28 millimeter projectile, that is shot 30 feet down this at 18,000 miles per hour or 8 kilometers per second.
That's a lot of force.
What I can't wrap my head around is that this thing is going 8 kilometers per second in 30 feet.
Show me where it ends up.
Sure.
The JASPER fires a projectile into a plutonium target, subjecting the material to high pressure, temperature, and strain. The shot collects information about the stability of the isotope and the viability of our nuclear arsenal.
This is the secondary confinement chamber, and what would be sitting inside here is the primary containment chamber that collects the projectile as it comes in and hits the plutonium.
Amazing. Now, if that chamber were breached or there was damage, this would contain everything.
Yes, that's why we have the secondary chamber.
Why? Why are we doing all this?
So this is just one of the tools that we have that helps us understand what's going on with our nuclear weapons. The scientists take the data from all of those experimental capabilities that we have at these facilities, put it together, and they're able to assure the continued safety, reliability of our nuclear weapons without having to do underground nuclear testing.
One of my great passions in life is to learn things, and so you have ignited my passion today because this has been fascinating to me. You've really taught me a lot, and I can't thank you enough for spending the day with me.
You're welcome.
It is impossible to remove the images of destruction from the atomic bomb era, but the knowledge found by wartime scientists informs the public, saves lives, and safely maintains nuclear energy sources and dormant weapons. As the expression goes, turning swords into plowshares.
This is one of my favorite kind of days. It really is. It combines science, history, exploration, great outdoors. On January 27, 1951, scientists and high-level military personnel sat right here and watched as the first bomb was dropped on the United States. But just 75 miles that way, there was another kind of viewing audience, and it was totally different.